breathe. For our deliverance has come through the power of the Son. Build up at once the church, the redeemed. Let the ants be silent, or winds cease to blow. Every created being must be freed. For there's a new song being sung with a new melody. It's of God, but the church, the redeemed.
We are in the army of the Lord. We've been washed in the blood, and we are going forth. We are in the army of the Lord. We've been washed in the blood, and we are going forth.
Every stronghold of bondage must fall beneath our feet. Every prisoner held captive must be freed. For our deliverance has come through the power of the Son. We are the blood of the church, the redeemed.
Oh, pick up your harp, O Zion of the Lord. Let the entering cloud of His praise. We are here to sing the glory of the Lord. Where the blood bought the church and redeemed.
We are in the army of the Lord. We've been washed in the blood, and we are going forth. We are in the army of the Lord. We've been washed in the blood, and we are going forth.
Stronghold of bondage must fall beneath our feet. Every prisoner held captive must be freed. For our deliverance has come through the power of the Son.
Praise the Lord. The hallelujah is weak. I said, praise the Lord. I welcome you to our Bible study tonight. And I pray that the study of tonight will enrich your life in Jesus' name. Show you the right way, the saving truth, the sanctifying truth, and the strengthening truth in your life in Jesus' name. And Jesus will be Lord of every area of our lives. Father, we thank you for this moment, for this hour. Thank you for bringing us to the point we study your word. We pray, Lord, we'll see you in the word. We'll taste your power in the word. And Lord, we'll submit to you that in every area and in all things, you'll be Lord of every life in Jesus' name. For friends, brothers and sisters who are coming here for the first time, we pray, Lord, Christ will be exalted even in their hearts in Jesus' name. For leaders, for workers, for members, for everyone, old-timers and newcomers, Lord, I pray that the word will touch the very string of every heart. And you make us to be the people we ought to be, lifting up Jesus, exalting Jesus, that he will be all in all, King of kings and Lord of lords, in every life, in Jesus' name. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. We're coming to Mark chapter 2. And tonight we're looking at verses 23 all through to 28. Mark chapter 2. I'm reading from verse 23. And it came to pass that he went through the cornfield on the Sabbath day, and his disciples began as they went to pluck the ears of corn. I want you to notice there, on the Sabbath day, because that will be the center of the study tonight, is the center of the argument, of the conflict, and of the confrontation of the Pharisees against the Lord Jesus and against his disciples. Look at verse 24 now. And the Pharisees said unto him, behold, why do they on the Sabbath day, that's it again, on the Sabbath day, that which is not lawful? They looked at the actions of the disciples of Christ, and Christ was not rebuking them. He wasn't correcting them. He led them to do as they were doing. And then the Pharisees had a problem with that, and they said, they do that which is not right, which is not lawful, which is not permissible on the Sabbath day. Why are they doing that? And why are you quiet about it? Here we come to verse 25. And he said unto them, have you never read what David did when he had need, that is when he was hungry and was and hungered, he and they that were with him? How he went into the house of God in the days of Abasa, the high priest, and did eat of the showbread, which is not lawful to eat but for the priests, and gave also them which were within. They asked a question, and Jesus answered their question. He cleared their doubts. He resolved the issue by asking them a question. Have you not read the scriptures? Have you not known what David did? Have you seen that what he did normally was not the normal thing, but there was nothing wrong in what he did? And now he brings the conclusion, verse 27. And he said unto them, the Sabbath was made for man. The Sabbath was made for the profit of man. The Sabbath was made for the good of man. And the Sabbath was made for the progress of man, and not man for the Sabbath. It's not that the man will be under the burden of the Sabbath, and then he will not have any kind of profit from that Sabbath. And now he told them the final thing about his lordship. He told them the final thing about his authority. He told them the final thing as the ultimate interpreter of the word of God and the law of God. In verse 28, therefore, the Son of Man is Lord also of the Sabbath. Amen. Amen. Tonight, we're looking at those verses of scripture, and we're looking at the lordship of Christ over the Sabbath, the lordship of Christ over the Sabbath. You want to understand that the law of Sabbath was given to the children of Israel for their good, but the Pharisees had turned it unto a yoke of oppression. And so there were a lot of things they said they couldn't do on the Sabbath day. They added to the word of God, and it was a great pile of pressure they added into the lives of the people. And what was profitable became unprofitable, and what was good became a burden unto the people. They had many laws. You remember the Ten Commandments, number one, number two, number three, and then number four is about the Sabbath. But it doesn't stop there. You have number five, number six, number seven, number eight, number nine, number ten. But they singled out and they isolated the fourth commandment about the Sabbath. and they now negated and they destroyed the effect of all the other commandments of God. And the Lord Jesus Christ spoke about them. He spoke to the multitude and he told them the attitude they ought to have to all the words of God. Look at Matthew chapter 23. In Matthew chapter 23, I'm reading from verse 1. Then spake Jesus to the multitude and to his disciples, saying, the scribes and the Pharisees sit in Moses' seat. All therefore whatsoever they bid you observe, that observe and do, but do not ye after their works, for they say and do not. You have one problem with the Pharisees, and you have such a problem today with many religious leaders, many religious preachers, many religious priests. They say and do not, and yet they sit in Moses' seat, and in that Moses' seat they read the law of Moses, they read the word of God. Number one, they do not have the strength because they were not born again. They did not have the power because the regeneration of heart has not taken place in their heart. They didn't have the power or the strength or the grace to do what they were reading or teaching. Then that's why he said, but they do not after their works, but they do not ye after their works, for they say and do not. Look at verse 4. It says in verse 4, for they bind heavy burdens and grievous to be borne, and lay them on men's shoulders. Religious people, religious oppressors, religious preachers, and religious worshippers, they laid burdens on other people, and those burdens themselves, they could not carry. Then it says, but they themselves will not move them with one of their fingers. They will not even touch those commandments. They laid it on people, and there are people today who preach, and they preach tough, and they preach hard, and it's very heavy, and yet they will not perform what they're preaching. And they will not do what they are teaching. They do not have the strength. They only talk, but they cannot walk the talk. We're coming to Mark chapter 7. In Mark chapter 7, the Lord also revealed their attitude, how they lived their lives, how they exalted tradition above the word of God. And the Lord is warning us that as children of God, as servants of God, as preachers of the word, we will not be like the Pharisees, that we isolate one doctrine, isolate one law, isolate one principle, and we even model up that principle or that law to the exclusion of all the other laws of God, and then all the other laws of God become of non-effect. Let's come to Mark chapter 7, and I'm reading from verse 5. Mark chapter 7 verse 5, then the Pharisees and scribes asked him, or asked the Lord Jesus another question now, why walk not thy disciples according to the tradition of the elders? They were not concerned with the word of God. They were not concerned with the law of God. All they were concerned about was the tradition of the elders. Then he goes on to say, but they eat with unwashing hands. That became a big deal. That became a great thing. Something in the realm of hygiene, something in the realm of physical natural cleanliness, becomes more important than the holiness of heart, than the obedience to the word of God in their own understanding. And we're watching the disciples. How are you eating like that? Are you continuing like that? How is it you are eating without the ceremonial washing of the hand? Look at verse 6. And he answered and said unto them, well, as Isaiah the prophet prophesied of you hypocrites, as it is written, the people honoreth me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. They were honoring the Lord in their worship, or their mouth, or their tongue, or their lips, but it says their heart not regenerated, their heart not cleansed, their heart not purified, their heart, they were not saved, they were not sanctified. It says it's far away from him. Why did Jesus say that? What did he observe in their lives? And what can we observe in the lives of many people today, in the lives and ministries of many preachers today? Look at it in verse 7, how be it in vain, do they worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men. Teaching for doctrines the commandments of men. They let the commandments of God alone. They will not preach the commandments of God. They will not emphasize the commandments of God. They will not call the people to stand for the doctrines of God, the word of God, but their own tradition. What tradition are they referring to here? Look at verse 8. For laying aside the commandment of God, ye hold the tradition of men. Laying aside the commandments of God, the word of God, the requirement of God, laying aside the standard of the word of God, it says, they held to the tradition of men as the washing of pots and cups and many other such like things ye do. Look at the example that Jesus gave, verse 9, and he said unto them, full well, ye reject the commandment of God, that she may keep your own tradition. Ye reject the commandment of God, that she may keep your own tradition. Their tradition became more important than the word of God. Their tradition became more important than the commandments of God. Their tradition, the tradition that cannot save, the tradition that will not lead them to heaven, the tradition that blocked their way before the Lord, the tradition that took holiness of heart away from them, they exalted that above the word of God. For Moses said in verse 10, honor thy father and thy mother, and whosoever curseth father or mother, let him die the dead. But she say, if a man shall say to his father or to his mother, it is korban. In their language, that korban means it's a gift. We offer that to God. Daddy, what you should have given me to take care of you, we have given it unto God. Mommy, what we should have given you to take care of you in your old age, we have given that to the Lord. A gift by whatsoever thou mightest be profited by me, he shall be free. And then it says, and ye suffer, ye permit, ye allow him no more to do aught for his father or his mother. Look at the conclusion, verse 13, making the word of God of none effect. Making the word of God of none effect through your tradition, which ye have delivered, and many such like things ye do. As you look at your own personal life, are there some traditional things? When I say tradition, I don't mean occultic. I don't mean idolatrous. I don't mean the things they do in the village. Tradition of a denomination, the tradition of a local church, the tradition of the elders. The elders want it this way. The preachers want it this way. Our denomination wants it this way. And the religious people want it this way. And then we forget the words of God. When the same boat then were the Pharisees that will not take the word of God, that will not believe the word of God, that will not emphasize the word of God, and tradition are taking over. And that tradition became so obvious in their understanding of the Sabbath day. Let's come back now to Mark chapter 2. Mark chapter 2. We're looking at the Lordship of Christ over the Sabbath. There are three things we're looking at. Number one, the provision of liberality for their sustenance. And the Lord looked at all his people, the children of Israel. He wanted to provide for them so that the poor will not lack and the rich will not oppress the poor. And so he made provision for them. Point number one, the provision of liberality for their sustenance. Point number two, the purpose of the law on Sabbath. Yes, God gave the law. And God wanted the children of Israel to understand that law, and then to follow through with that law, and to obey the word of God on that law. The purpose of the law on Sabbath. Point number three, the preeminence of the Lord our Savior. The preeminence of the Lord our Savior. He is the Lord of the Sabbath as well. We come to point number one, the provision of liberality for their sustenance. We're coming to Mark chapter 2, and I'm reading from verse 23. And it came to pass that he went through the cornfields on the Sabbath day, and his disciples began as they went to pluck the ears of corn. As a believer, what do you think of that? The Lord Jesus Christ was going on his normal evangelistic work. And as he was passing through, he had to pass through a field. There was a pass in that field. And on either side of that pass, of that road, there were corn. There was the stacks of corn that the disciples now would just stretch their hand and pluck and rub together and blow the chaff away and then put in their mouth, because they were hungry. But they didn't know the owner, and they didn't know the person that had planted everything there. How could they do that? Was that permitted? Actually, the Lord had made that provision for the children of Israel, and it was for their sustenance, and they were not guilty at all. Let's look at Deuteronomy chapter 23. Deuteronomy chapter 23, I'm reading from verse 24. Deuteronomy chapter 23, verse 24. So you will see the reason why they did what they did, and they were not guilty. You will see why they did what they did, and they were not condemned by the Lord. Deuteronomy chapter 23, verse 24. When thou comest into thy neighbor's vineyard, then thou mayest eat grapes thy fill at thine own pleasure. But thou shalt not put any in thy vessel. It says for the children of Israel, as we are going through the field, as we are going through the vineyard, if you have any need to pluck any of the vines, you're free to do that. Only you must not put anything in a vessel to carry away. You can take it there and eat it there. Look at verse 25. When thou comest into the standing corn of thy neighbor, then thou mayest pluck the ears with thine hand, but thou shalt not move a sickle unto thy neighbor's standing corn. If you are passing through the field and then there are standing corns, you can pluck out of that and eat. It was the provision the Lord had made for all the children of Israel without any discrimination. We're looking at Leviticus chapter 19, the provision of liberality for their sustenance. Leviticus chapter 19, we're looking at it from verse 9. In Leviticus 19, verse 9, here is what the word of God tells us concerning the state and concerning the provision of the Lord for the children of Israel. And when you reap the harvest of your land, thou shalt not wholly, completely, entirely reap the corners of thy field, neither shalt thou gather the gleanings of thy harvest. The Lord told the farmers, he told the people that were planting, when you are reaping, you must not reap everything, clean everything, glean everything, take everything away. It says in verse 10, and thou shalt not glean thy vineyard, neither shalt thou gather every grape of thy vineyard. Thou shalt leave them for the poor. Thou shalt leave them for the poor and the stranger. I am the Lord your God. You see the provision the Lord made? He made that provision for the poor in the land and the strangers in the land. You might not even know them, but you leave part of the grace and part of the planting for them. It says, and ye shall not steal, neither deal falsely, neither lie one to another. You see, what they did was not stealing. It was a provision that had been made for the children of Israel. We're coming to Deuteronomy chapter 24. Deuteronomy chapter 24. We're reading from verse 19. Deuteronomy chapter 24. Reading from verse 19. Because many of us are not familiar with, you know, that kind of attitude, that kind of action. You're going through the field in Israel, and then you are hungry, you stretch out your hand and then pluck the grains of corn and then put your mouth and eat. Is that right? It was right for them. It was okay for them. Although in the Gentile nation, you cannot be going through the field of anyone here in your Gentile nation and then pluck it, that will be stealing. But in their own case, it was a provision the Lord had made for them. Deuteronomy chapter 24. Reading from verse 19. Deuteronomy chapter 24, verse 19. When thou cuttest down thy harvest in thy field, and hast forgot a sheep in the field, thou shalt not go again to fetch it. If the farmer was kind of reaping his harvest, and he bundled those things together, and he forgot a bundle, the word of God says to that Israelite, don't go back to pick it up. Let that be in the hands of the poor and the strangers. It shall be for the stranger, it shall be for the fatherless, it shall be for the widow, that the Lord thy God may bless thee in all the work of thine hands. It says, if you leave something like that for the widow, for the fatherless, for the orphan, and the widow, the orphan, and the fatherless, and they're able to eat that, it will be a blessing for you from the Lord. Look at verse 20. It says in verse 20, when thou beatest thine olive tree, thou shalt not go over the boughs again. It shall be for the stranger, for the fatherless, and for the widow. It says, always remember the poor, and leave something behind for the poor. Leave something behind for the widow. Leave something behind for the fatherless. It says in verse 21, when thou gatherest the grapes of thy vineyard, thou shalt not glean it afterward. Don't, you know, go over there again and glean it all over again. It says, thou shalt not glean it afterwards. It shall be for the stranger, it shall be for the fatherless, it shall be for the widows. I'm sure you have seen a principle in this. All your possession, all your earnings, all your riches, all your wealth, you don't spend everything on yourself. There are poor people in the land. There are fatherless people in the neighborhood, and there are widows in the neighborhood. You will think about them, and part of your earnings and part of your health and part of your income will go to them and take care of them. Leviticus chapter 25, we're reading from verse 6. Leviticus chapter 25, we're reading from verse 6. It says in verse 6 of Leviticus chapter 25. Chapter 25, Leviticus verse 6. And the Sabbath of the land shall be meat for you. The Sabbath of the land shall be meat for you, for thee, and for thy servants, and for thy maid, and for thy hired servant, and for thy stranger that sojourneth with thee, for thy cattle, and for thy beasts, that thou that art in the land shall all thy increase thereof be meat. It says that the increase of the land will be for everybody. The Sabbath is for you. The provision is for you. All those standing corns is for everyone. And so the poor can go in there if they were hungry, and they will be satisfied. We're looking at Exodus chapter 23. Exodus chapter 23. We're reading from verse 11. Exodus chapter 23, verse 27. Verse 11, it was a provision by the Lord that none of the children of Israel will die of hunger. And I pray that none of the children of God in our church will die of hunger in Jesus' name. We'll make provision for them. We'll make allowance for them. In our eating, we'll make allowance for them. In our clothing ourselves, we'll make allowance for them. And in our educating our own children, we'll make allowance for the other children who have no father, no mother to send them to school. The provision the Lord had made for the children of Israel is for the liberality of everyone, for their sustenance. Exodus chapter 23, verse 11, it says, "For the seventh year thou shalt let it rest and lie still, that the poor of thy people may eat." Look at that provision the Lord gave them. He said, you have been toiling, you have been harvesting for first year, second year, third year, fourth and fifth and sixth. On the seventh year, you will not even go there to reap anything, to gather anything. You will leave everything for the poor of the land. What a great provision the Almighty God made for everyone. Look at that again, verse 11. "But the seventh year thou shalt let it rest," let the land rest and lie still, "that the poor of thy people may eat. And what they leave, the beasts of the field shall eat." After the poor people have satisfied themselves, and then anything still remained, even the beasts of the field, provision was made for them. "In like manner shalt thou deal with thy vineyard and with thy olive yard." Remember what you are talking about? The provision of liberality for the sustenance of the people of God. Let's come to the New Testament now and see what the Lord is telling us, what we learn from that. How we're to be generous, how we're to be giving people, how we're to take care of the poor, how we're to take care of strangers. In 2 Corinthians chapter 9, 2 Corinthians chapter 9, I'm reading from verse 8. "And God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that ye always having all sufficiency in all things may abound to every good work." You know what that is saying? It's saying when God has provided for you and you have all sufficiency in all things, you are not to consume everything upon yourself, and you are not to eat everything by yourself, you are not to spend everything by yourself, that it will make you abound unto every good work. Every good work, taking care of your neighbors, that's good work. And taking care of the sick, that's a good work. Taking care of the people who are poor, that's a good work. And taking care of the underprivileged people, that's a good work. When the Lord has provided for you material things, he has provided for you all that you need to take care of your life, it says you now need to abound in every good work. Look at verse 9. "As it is written," it's according to what is written, is the word of God, "he has dispersed abroad, he has given to the poor." That's a Christian, that's a believer. In your life, you must have the testimony that you are a generous person, that you are a giving person, that the people who are less privileged than you are, they are benefiting from your possession. They are benefiting from your wealth. They are benefiting from your provision. He has given to the poor. His righteousness remaineth forever. He has righteousness because he's giving to the poor. He has righteousness. The Lord has changed his heart, has touched his heart, and is not selfish, is not self-centered. He is a person that is giving out. The grace of God is manifested in his life. Romans chapter 12, I read from verse 13. Romans chapter 12, verse 13. Distributing to the necessity of saints, giving to hospitality, abandoned to hospitality, addicted to hospitality. It means in our lives, you must find somebody that doesn't have as much as you have. You must find somebody that dying of hunger and they're dying in penury, and the Lord has provided for you. It says the Christian life makes provision of liberality for the sustenance of other people. You're distributing to the necessity of the saints. Saints, those are believers like yourself, but they do not have everything that you have, and you're giving, you're addicted, and you're totally, entirely giving to hospitality. We're looking at Galatians chapter 2, and I'm reading from verses 9 and 10. Galatians chapter 2, and we're reading from verses 9 and 10. It says in verse 9, and when James and Cephas, that's Peter, and John, who seemed to be pillars in the church, they perceived the grace that was given to me. They gave to me and Barnabas the right hand of fellowship, that we should go unto the heathen, and they to the circumcision. Look at what is happening here. Paul the apostle with Barnabas had been preaching the word unto the Gentiles, and Peter, James, and John had faced the ministry of the Jews, and now they said that they saw the grace of God in them, and they gave them the right hand of fellowship. Look at verse 10. Only they would that we should remember the poor. Only they would, these pillars of the church who were ministering to the circumcision and ministering to the Jews, they knew the provision for the Jews, that there's liberality provided by the people who are rich and well-to-do in the Jewish world for the poor. They said, now as we're preaching to the Gentiles, let them know that such provision is also available. Only they would that we should remember the poor, the same which I also was forward to do. We're looking at Galatians chapter 6, and I read from verses 9 and 10. Galatians chapter 6, from verse 9, it says, let us not be weary in well-doing, feeding the poor. Let us not be weary in well-doing, clothing the naked. Let us not be weary in well-doing, providing for the needy. Let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. As we have therefore opportunity, let us do good unto all men. You are not even limiting it to members of your church or members of the body of Christ. Even those who are just men, they're just creatures of God, and they're sinners, and they're your neighbors, and you find that they do not have the wherewithal to make a living. It says, let us do good to all men, especially to them who are the household of faith. I pray God will touch every heart. I say God will touch every heart. You'll not want to see people go hungry and you'll not do something about it. You'll not want to see people completely impoverished and you'll not do something about it. You'll make provision like God has made for the liberality of the sustenance of the people. We're coming to Acts chapter 20. Acts chapter 20. And I'm reading from verse 35. I have showed you all things, how that so laboring, ye ought to support the weak. Ye ought to support the weak. Ye ought to provide for the poor, and to remember the words of the Lord Jesus Christ, how he said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. It is more blessed to give than to receive. You see, there are Christians that have the idea, I'm always getting from other people, give me, give me, give me. And Jesus said, we need to learn how to give as well. Even the little you have, you can take a little fraction out of that and be a blessing to the life of another person, to the family in your neighborhood, and to your neighbor also around you, because of the words of Jesus, it is more blessed to give than to receive. Now, if you have been receiving and you never give, how about if everybody behaved like you? If everybody acted like you, that they're always asking and they're not giving out. Remember the words of Jesus Christ, and let what you have become part of the provision for the people around you, the provision of liberality for their sustenance. So we'll come to point number two now, which is the purpose of the law on Sabbath. The purpose of the law on Sabbath. Sometimes when you have a law, you have a commandment, but you don't know the purpose, and you just obey that commandment without any purpose and without any goal, without the understanding that this is the word of the Lord, and this is the reason why the Lord gave that word, and this is my responsibility as a result of that law. You might even obey that law, but because you are purposeless, you do not understand, you are not able to fulfill the will of God and please the mind of the Almighty. We're coming back to Mark chapter 2, and I'm reading from verse 24. And the Pharisees said unto him, behold, why do they on the Sabbath day, on the Sabbath day in particular, that which is not lawful? They didn't know what was lawful. They didn't know what was right. They didn't know what was righteous. They didn't understand the purpose of the law on Sabbath. And now Jesus answered them, and he said unto them, have you never read? Are you only reading Sabbath passage? Have you never read the rest of the Bible? Are you only reading the law on commandment? And you have never read any other part of the Old Testament? Have you never read what David did when he had need? And he was an hungered, he was hungry. He and they that were with him, how he went into the house of God in the days of Abasa the high priest, and did eat the showbread. Did eat the showbread. The showbread was a kind of sacred bread. They would put that on the table in the holy place. Their tabernacle was divided into three parts: the outer court, the holy place, and then the holy of holies. The holy of holies was the most sacred place. The high priest went there only once a year. But in the holy place, in the middle apartment, they will set the bread there when it was fresh. It was a symbol of their offering to the Lord. You've given us so much bread, so much food, and we're offering this to you. And then after a day, they'll take the showbread off that table. Only the priest could eat of that. But David was not a priest, he was a king. And the people that were with David, they were not priests, they were soldiers, they were followers of David. But now they were hungry, and life was being threatened. And because life was threatened, they had to abandon and forget the law that ordinary people should not eat the showbread. And it was given to David and the people with him. It says, which is not lawful to eat, but for the priest, and gave also to them that were with him. They said, haven't you read that God did not condemn them? Let's come to Luke chapter 10. Luke chapter 10. Those Pharisees, they had the letter of the word, and they could quote the word. They knew something about the Sabbath, but they didn't understand the purpose of the law on Sabbath. We're coming to Luke chapter 10, and I'm reading from verse 26. It said unto them, what is written in the law? How readest thou? What is written in the law? Anytime you have a question, anytime you have confusion, anytime you have any conflict, and you are wondering, why are they doing that? How could they do that? Can I do that too? go back to the word of God, because Jesus said, this is how you resolve every problem, and this is how you answer every question. This is how you put everything right in your life. It says, what is written in the law, how readest thou? And he answering said, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thine heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy strength, and with all thy mind, and thy neighbor as thyself. Now your neighbor is dying. If you love him, what are you going to do? Your neighbor is hungry. If you love him, what are you going to do? It's on the Sabbath day, but he's sick. If you were the one that was sick, how would you want people to react to you? It says you love your neighbor as yourself. But you see those Pharisees and those scribes, let's see what happened to them. Acts chapter 13. Acts of the Apostles chapter 13. I'm reading from verse 27. Acts chapter 13, verse 27. For they that dwell at Jerusalem, the Jews and their rulers, all the members of the Sanhedrin, because they knew not him, nor yet the voices of the prophets which are read every Sabbath day. They didn't know that voice. They didn't understand that voice. They didn't understand the Lord. They read the word on the Sabbath, and they read it on every Sabbath day, and yet they didn't understand. They have fulfilled them in condemning him. Until today, religious people who read the Old Testament, and the veil is not taken away from them. The religious people who read the Old Testament, and they do not understand the purpose of the law. They do not understand the reason why God gave the law that he gave. They still fall into the trap. They still fall into the same mistake. It tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 3. 2 Corinthians chapter 3. I'm reading here from verse 14. 2 Corinthians chapter 3. We're reading from verse 14. But their minds were blinded. They read, but their minds are blinded. They study, but their minds are blinded. The tradition blindfolds them. And the doctrine of the elders, doctrine of men, blindfolds them. Their minds were blinded, for until this day remaineth the same covering, the same veil, untaken away. In the reading of the Old Testament, which veil is done away in Christ. They read, they can't understand, because their minds are blind, because their understanding is dull, and because the word of God is not expounded to their mind, to their heart, and the word of God is not clear to them. And because of that, they can read and read. I read 5 chapters today. I read 10 chapters today. I've read this and that since the year began. But the veil is on their heart. The covering is on their heart. And the covering and the veil has not been taken away. But when we come to Christ, that's one of the things Christ does. He cleanses us, and he removes the veil, and he opens the scriptures. He opens the word unto us. Look at verse 15. But even unto this day, unto this day, unto this day, when Moses is read, when they read Genesis, or they read Exodus, or they read Leviticus, or they read Numbers, or they read Deuteronomy, the veil is upon their heart. Nevertheless, when it shall turn to the Lord, the veil shall be taken away. I pray that every veil will be taken away from your heart, and from your mind, and from your understanding, in Jesus' name. Let's look at the purpose why God gave them the law on Sabbath. Gave Israel in particular. We're looking at Deuteronomy chapter 5, verse 15. Deuteronomy chapter 5, we're reading from verse 15. Notice what it says. And remember that thou was a servant in the land of Egypt, and the Lord thy God brought thee out thence through a mighty hand and by a stretched out arm. Look at this now. Therefore, the Lord thy God commanded thee, Israelites, commanded thee, the Jews, to keep the Sabbath day. It's not a universal thing. It's not an international thing. He commanded thee that he brought out of the land of Egypt. He commanded thee to keep the Sabbath day. We're coming to Ezekiel chapter 20 and verse 12. Ezekiel chapter 20, we're reading from verse 12. The Sabbath was given to the children of Israel, and the purpose is stated clearly. Let's look at chapter 20 of Ezekiel, and I'm reading from verse 12. Ezekiel chapter 20, verse 12. Moreover, also, I gave them, the children of Israel, my Sabbath, to be a sign between me and them. The children of Israel, he gave the Sabbath to the children of Israel to be a sign between me and them, that they might know that I am the Lord that sanctify them, that they might know that I am the Lord. The Lord, what did he give them? The Sabbath. So that on the Sabbath day they will rest from work. On the Sabbath day, they will go to their synagogue. On the Sabbath day, they'll go to the sanctuary. They will hear the word of God. They will know God more. They will love God more. And they will know that he is the one who sanctifies. They'll hear about salvation. They'll hear about sanctification. They'll hear about holiness. They'll hear about the will of God. They'll hear about the word of God. They'll hear about the rest and the provision he has made for us and for them in heaven. Look at verse 20. Ezekiel chapter 20. I'm reading verse 20. And hallow my Sabbaths, and they shall be a sign between me and you. Talking to the children of Israel, he said, it's a sign between you and I, that ye may know that I am the Lord your God. I set apart the Sabbath for you, for the children of Israel, so that the priests, the preachers, and the prophets will come before them and declare to them the word of God on their Sabbath day. We're coming to Isaiah chapter 56. Isaiah chapter 56, the purpose of the law on Sabbath. It tells us from verse 1. Look at verse 1. Thus says the Lord, keep ye judgment and do justice, for my salvation is near to come, and my righteousness to be revealed. He wanted them to keep the Sabbath so that as they leave their farm and they leave all the places they are working in, they go to the sanctuary, they go to the temple, they go to the place of worship, and they'll hear about salvation that is near. You'll hear about righteousness that is revealed. Blessed is the man that doeth this, the son of man that lays hold on it, that keepeth the Sabbath from polluting it, that keepeth the Sabbath from defiling it, that keepeth the Sabbath from turning to a day of commerce, a day of corruption, and keepeth his son from doing any evil. What's the purpose of the Sabbath? You are to go to the sanctuary and hear the word of God and know that this is evil, run away from that. This is evil, depart from that. This is evil, get away from that. It says in verse 3, neither let the son of the stranger that has joined himself to the Lord speak, saying, the Lord has utterly separated me from his people. Neither let the eunuch say, behold, I am a dry tree. For thus says the Lord unto the eunuchs that keep my Sabbaths. You get to the Sabbath and you get to the sanctuary, you'll hear of the promises of God. You'll hear of the power of God. And you'll hear that it's possible for God to turn your life around. And it says, the eunuchs that keep my Sabbath and choose the things that please me and take hold of my covenant. When you go to the sanctuary on that Sabbath day and you leave every work and you leave the office work and you leave everything, then you will hear that God is pleased when this is done. and you will choose the things that please the Lord, and you'll take hold of the covenant of the Lord. Verse 5, even unto them will I give in mine house, and within my walls a place and a name better than the sons, better than of daughters. I will give them an everlasting name that they shall not be cut off. That's the purpose he gave it to them, so that they will hear of the promise that he made for them, and so they will not be cut off. Verse 6, also the sons of the stranger that joined themselves to the Lord to serve him and to love the name of the Lord, to be a servant. It says it's at that time when you set apart that Sabbath, you will know what it means to love the Lord with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind. And then he goes on to say, to be his servants, everyone that keepeth the Sabbath from polluting it, and taketh hold of my covenant. Even them will I bring to my holy mountain, and make them joyful in my house of prayer. It was set apart so that they will dedicate that day to hearing the word of God, knowing the promises of God, knowing the will of God, and praying. They come to the house of God for that purpose. And it says they'll make a joyful noise in the house of prayer, and their burnt offerings and their sacrifices shall be accepted upon mine altar. Look at this. For mine house shall be called an house of prayer for all people. The strangers, the poor, the widow, the fatherless, everyone, as they come to the house of God on that Sabbath day, they will know how to connect with God, and they will know how to live a life pleasing to God. In verse 8, the Lord God will that gathereth the outcasts of Israel, yet will I gather others to him. That is, it's a day to also bring in other people. It's a day to evangelize. I will gather others to him beside those that are gathered unto him. Besides the regular members, others too will come. The Pharisees forgot all about that. The Pharisees did not understand the purpose of the Sabbath, to evangelize and to edify the people that come to the sanctuary. We're coming to chapter 58, Isaiah chapter 58. I'm reading from verse 13. Isaiah chapter 58, verse 13. If thou turn away thy foot from the Sabbath, from doing thy pleasure on my holy day, not holiday, holy day, not vacation, holy day. For them, it was a time for them to remember that our God is holy, and the people that worship him must be holy, upright, and righteous. And they will turn away from doing their own pleasure. It's not a day for entertainment. It's not a day for sports. It's not a day for photography. It's not a day for just pleasures of the flesh. It is a day for them to remember that without holiness no man shall see the Lord. And then it says, and call the Sabbath a delight. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. They'll call the Sabbath a delight, a holy, the holy of the Lord, honorable, and shall honor him. It's a day to honor the Lord. It's a day to just say, concentrate totally on the word of God that he had given to them. Not doing thy own ways, nor finding thy own pleasure, nor speaking thine own words. Then shalt thou delight thyself in the Lord. If you keep that Sabbath, he was telling the children of Israel, and I will cause thee to ride upon the high places of the earth, and feed thee with the heritage of Jacob thy father, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken it. Now for us today, why don't we keep Saturday, the seventh day, the Sabbath? Why do we gather together on the first day of the week? In Matthew chapter 28, our redemption was accomplished on that first day of the week. For the children of Israel, The Lord gave them the Sabbath, the seventh day, because he brought them out of captivity, and because he brought them out of the bondage of Egypt. But for us, we were not in Egypt, but all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And on the first day of the week, Jesus rose from the dead, and he gave us redemption, and he gave us justification, and he gave us salvation. And because of that, the New Testament believers now began to gather on the first day of the week for the children of God, for the redeemed of the Lord. Matthew chapter 28. I'm reading from verse 1. Matthew 28 verse 1. In the end of the Sabbath. Notice that. In the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulchre. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. And his countenance was like lightning, and his raiment white as snow. And for fear of him, the keepers did shake and became as dead men. And the angel answered and said unto the women, fear not ye, for I know that ye seek Jesus, which is crucified, which was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen. Our Lord is risen. I said, our Lord is risen. He's risen, as he said, come, see the place where the Lord lay, and go quickly and tell his disciples on this first day of the week, go and tell them that he is risen from the dead, and behold, he goeth before you into Galilee. There shall you see him, and lo, I have told you. And they departed quickly from the sepulchre with fear and with great joy, and did run to bring the disciples word. On the first day of the week, first day of the week. I hope you notice that. Come back to verse 1. At the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week. The first day of the week. That's when the resurrection of Jesus Christ took place. And after that, the believers now commemorating that resurrection on the first day of the week began to meet together on the first day of the week, which is Sunday. In Acts of the Apostles chapter 20 verse 7. Acts chapter 20 verse 7. And upon the first day of the week, you see that? Upon the first day of the week, when the disciples came together to break bread. The disciples came together to break bread. On the first day of the week, the Lord Jesus Christ has said, do this in remembrance of me. They didn't do it on the Sabbath. They did it on the first day of the week. And upon the first day of the week, when the disciples came together to break bread, Paul preached unto them. The preaching now shifted to the first day of the week, the exhortation and the lifting up of the hands of the people to love the Lord with all their heart, all their soul, all their mind. The word and the gospel on salvation. The word and the gospel on holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. The word that will show that now we're identified with Christ. That was now given to them on the first day of the week, ready to depart on the morrow. And he continued his speech until, tell me, are you there? I said he continued his speech until midnight. You know, there are some people, they cannot stay, you know, 1 hour service. They say it's too long, 3 hours is too long. But you know, those people, they knew the whole day was totally committed unto the Lord. When they were Jews and when they were in the old covenant, the whole of the Sabbath day was committed to the preaching of the word, exhorting them and challenging them and sacrificing and praying. Everything was committed to the Lord. Now that we are on the Sunday side. We are on the first day of the week. Paul the Apostle continued until the midnight. We're coming to 1 Corinthians chapter 16. 1 Corinthians chapter 16. I'm reading from verse 1. In 1 Corinthians chapter 16 verse 1, now concerning the collection for the saints, you see that again, collection for the saints, those who are poor, those who are impoverished, those who have nothing to make ends meet, the saints, they were children of God, but we are to make a collection for them. Concerning the collection for the saints, as I have given order to the churches of Galatia, even so do ye. When do we make the collection? Look at this, verse 2. Upon the first day of the week. Upon the first day of the week. No more Sabbath, but now the first day of the week. Let every one of you lay by him his store, as God has prospered him, that there be no collections, gatherings when I come. That first day of the week then became the Lord's Day, the Lord's Day. When people gather together, the Lord's Day. When you hear the Lord's Day, that means the first day of the week. Revelation chapter 1. Revelation chapter 1, I'm reading from verse 10. Revelation chapter 1, verse 10, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. Be filled with the Spirit. And when you're filled with the Spirit, you offer praises to God and sing unto God and look at the word of God and take in the word of God. And John, the beloved, said, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, and I heard behind me a great voice as of a trumpet saying, I am Alpha and Omega, the first and the last. What thou seest, write in a book and send it to the seven churches which are in Asia. The message you are sending to them, it came on the first day of the week. It came on the Lord's day. That's to Ephesus and to Smyrna and to Pergamos and to Thyatira and to Sardis and to Philadelphia and to Laodicea. And I turned to see the voice that spake with me, and being turned, I saw seven golden candlesticks representing the churches, and in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks, one like unto the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to the foot, and girt about with palms, with bells, with a golden girdle. And he said, and his ears were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes as a flame of fire. The Lord was revealing himself to John so he can reveal to the church, and that was done on the Lord's day, the first day of the week. And his feet like as of fine brass, as if they burnt in a furnace, and his voice as the sound of many waters. And he had in his right hand seven stars, and out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword, and we see, and his countenance was as the sun shineth in his strength on the Lord's day. And when I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead, worshipping on the Lord's day. And he laid his right hand upon me, saying unto me, fear not. The encouragement comes on the first day. And this encouragement came to John on the Lord's day. I am the first and the last. I am he that liveth and was dead. And behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And have the keys of hell and death. He said he has all authority. He has all power. And he revealed all this on the first day of the week. And then when the first day of the week comes, you must remember there's a purpose for that first day of the week. As the children of Israel served God and worshiped God, went to their sanctuary and went to their temple, had the word of God, read the word of God, prayed unto the Lord on their Sabbath day. We now, as New Testament believers, we come to the Lord and we serve him and we worship him and we hear his word and we dedicate our lives unto the Lord on this this first day of the week, I pray, will not slide back into the error of the Pharisees in Jesus' name. Will not slide back to tradition. Will not slide back to religion without righteousness. There will be redemption, and then there will be righteousness, and will serve the Lord all the days of our lives appropriately, acceptably in Jesus' name. Did anybody say amen over there?
Amen.
Point number three now, the preeminence of the Lord our Savior. The preeminence of the Lord our Savior. We're coming back to Mark chapter 2. Mark chapter 2, I read from verse 27. And he said unto them, the Sabbath was made for man. How do you understand that? The Sabbath was made for man. It was to be a day of rest from physical labor, so that man will recover his physical strength that he had lost all those 6 days of working. The Sabbath was made for man. The Sabbath was made for man because of his soul and because of his spirit. He had been laboring and exercising his physical strength, his physical body, all those 6 days. On the Sabbath, he will now come and bring his soul before the Lord. His soul will be refreshed. His soul will be renewed. His soul will be restored. Because the Sabbath was made for the good of man. The Sabbath was made for man. On earth here, he walks and walks and walks, and he doesn't think about, how about eternity? Where will I spend eternity? On the Sabbath day is when he comes to the sanctuary, and then he hears the word of God. All the confusion of his life and all the wrong placement of his life, everything is taken away, and he's able to now prepare for glory and for heaven. The Sabbath was made for man, and not man for the Sabbath. Not man for the Sabbath. Therefore, the Son of Man is Lord also of the Sabbath. And when you glorify God on the Lord's day, you're making him the Lord. When you make him the all in all, when you give him number one position, and when you seek first the righteousness of God for all other things to be added unto you, you're making him the Lord of your life and the Lord of that day. So that merriment will not be the Lord of your Sunday. I said, merriment will not be the Lord of your Sunday. Traveling from here to there, I'm going for business, I'm going for that. That will not be the most important thing on your Sunday in Jesus' name. But worshiping the Lord, giving yourself to the Lord, surrendering to the Lord, and owning him, accepting him as your Lord and your God. In John chapter 20, I'm reading from verse 26. In John chapter 20, reading from verse 26. And after 8 days, remember, Jesus rose on the first day of the week. And now to appear to his own disciples after 8 days, after he did, that means seventh day has gone, Sabbath day has gone. The next week, which is the first day of the week, will mean the eighth day. And after 8 days, again, his disciples were with him, and Thomas was them. And then came Jesus, the doors being shut, and stood in the midst and said, peace be unto you. The peace of God be unto you. Then said he to Thomas, reach hither, and with thy finger, and behold my hands, and reach hither thy hands, and thrust it into my side, and be not faithless, but believing. And Thomas answered and said, my Lord and my God. On that first day of the week, that is of this second week, now the eighth day, when Christ appeared to them, he now knew that it's the Lord, it's the Lord. When you come to the Lord on Sunday, on the first day of the week, then you recognize that Jesus Christ is Lord. He's Lord of all. He's Lord of your life. He's Lord of your heart. He's Lord of your family. When you come to worship and you hear the word of God and you see the symbols and the signs that Jesus Jesus has risen from the dead for your justification. Then you understand, and then you remember that Jesus is your Lord and is your God. Jesus says unto him, Thomas, because thou hast seen me, thou hast believed. Blessed are they that have not seen me and yet have believed. That is your blessing. I said that is your blessing. You know him as Lord, although you've not seen him physically. How do we get saved today? By making him Lord, by making him a Savior. In Romans chapter 10, verse 9, Romans chapter 10, verse 9, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lordship of Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God has raised him up from the dead, thou shalt be saved. The important thing now, the emphasis now, is that he rose from the dead, and he rose on the first day of the week. And if you believe in your heart that Christ rose from the dead and he rose for your justification, it says thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Must receive him as Lord. He's the Lord of glory. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 7 and 8. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 7. It says, but we speak wisdom, the wisdom of God, in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world for our glory, which none of the princes of this world knew, for had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. He's the Lord of glory. He's the Lord of our lives. He's the Lord of the whole universe. And as we recognize him as such, then he lives as strong and mighty in our lives. Colossians chapter 2, Colossians chapter 2, verses 16 to 19. Colossians chapter 2, verse 16. Let no man therefore judge you in meat or in drink or in respect of an holy day or of the new moon or of Sabbath days. Don't let any Jewish worshiper condemn you and say, you're not worshiping on the Sabbath. Don't let any Sabbatarian condemn you that you're not worshiping on the Sabbath day. It says, let no man therefore judge you in meat or in drink or in the respect of an holy day or of the new moon or of the Sabbath days, which are a shadow of things to come. All those things that the Lord established with the children of Israel are a shadow, and the reality has now come. That's the Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior, who died, and then he rose again on the first day of the week. And that Lord's day now gets us together, and we worship him. It says in verse 18, let no man beguile you of your reward in a voluntary humility and worshiping of angels, intruding into those things which he has not seen, vainly puffed up by his fleshly mind, and not holding the head, from which all the body by joints and bands, having a nourishment ministered and knit together, increases to the increase of God. Will increase in Jesus' name. Now Christ has become the Lord of all, and because of that, we worship him as a Savior, as a sanctifier, as a baptizer in the Holy Ghost, as a healer, as a provider of everything, as a sufficiency. In the Philippians chapter 2, Philippians chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 5, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, is a son of God, equal with God the Father, and now is Lord of all. And he made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men, and being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross, that is, for salvation and for redemption. Wherefore God also has highly exalted him. God also has highly exalted him, and then he has given him a name above every name. Giving him a name above the name of Moses, above the name of Aaron, above the name of the law. He's giving him a name above every name, that at the name of Jesus, tell me, every knee shall bow of things in heaven, and of things in earth, and of things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ, tell me, is Lord, to the glory of the Father. He is Lord. I said he is Lord. He'll be the Lord of your life, the Lord of your family, the Lord of every day in your life, the Lord of your aspiration, and the Lord of your ambition, and the Lord that will take you to heaven, in Jesus' name. Revelation chapter 19, I'm reading from verse 15. Revelation chapter 19, verse 15. And out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it he shall smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron. And he treadeth the winepress of the fierceness and the wrath of the Almighty God. And he has on his vesture and on his thigh a name written. Tell me the name. Shout out the name. That's our Jesus, King of kings and Lord of lords. That's the one that rose from the dead on the first day of the week, King of kings and Lord of lords. That's the Lord of the Sabbath. That's the Lord of Sunday. That's the Lord of every day in your life. That's the Lord of your future. That's the Lord of everything in your life. He's King of kings and Lord of lords. I pray he'll be Lord in your life. He'll be Lord in your family. He'll be Lord over every circumstance in your life. He wants us to remember, whether it's Sabbath day or the first day of the week, Sunday, or it's any other day, whether it's the time you're born again, or the time you're moving on with the Lord, or the time of the rapture, the Son of Man is Lord of every day. And he'll have dominion over your life. He'll have power over your life. And you will not dodge, you'll not shirk, you'll not run away from the Lordship of Christ, in Jesus' name. Rise up now and declare, he is Lord, he is Lord, he is Lord. He rose from the dead for your justification. He is Lord. He rose from the dead for the supply of every need in your life. He is Lord. And remember, the word he has given us, his word has authority and lordship over us in your life. You are not going to spend your life selfishly. You are going to provide for the liberality of the sustainers of all people around you. And you will remember the light of the Lord's day. You remember the purpose of the Lord's day. You remember, and you're not just here at home. I cannot go to church today. You shall be glad when they say unto you, let us go into the house of the Lord. And then you make the Lord Jesus Christ preeminent, prominent in your life. And all the days of your life, Jesus will be number one. Every day, Jesus as number one, the Lord of your life. Open your mouth and tell the Lord, he is Lord.